Hello, everybody, and welcome back to Mission Control. This is a podcast focusing on executive directors and nonprofit leaders and how they strive to make positive impacts in their community. I'm your host, Paul Schmidt, owner and creative video strategist for UnoDeuce Multimedia, and I would like to welcome to the program the executive director of Building Twentyone, Ben Schartow. Hey, Ben, how you doing?
Hey, Paul. Hey, doing great, man. It's a fun day out right now, so...
For those that don't know, we're here in Michigan and we're having another wonderful Michigan winter day.
Yeah, got some ice going on and, you know, people are calling me if things are canceled and all of that fun stuff. So,
yay, awesome. But anyway, to how we really start the show, since it's called Mission Control, it's about you talking about your mission and how you control it. What is the mission of Building 21?
Yeah, well, Building 21 is we're a nonprofit after school teen center, and we have programs, activities for teenagers. And our mission is we are helping students create healthy habits and values and coaching them to find their passion and purpose so that they can be actively engaged in their families, schools, and communities. And that looks a lot of different ways through enrichment programs, after school activities. We have Friday Night Live party, you know, Friday Night Live activities that go on to help really in the most volatile time with teenagers, which is 3 to 6 in the afternoon and 7 and 9 on weekends. And so that's who we are. You know, our vision, our mission also includes when people ask me about Building 21, they say, what's the 21? Well, research shows it takes 21 days to form a habit. And so we're helping create healthy habits, and our values really encompass character, trust, hope, potential, and influence. If we were to boil it down into what habits or what are we trying to create and help students with, well, that's it. Those are our values: character, trust, hope, potential, and influence.
Wow. And right off the bat, you answer my very first question in Building 21. What does the 21 mean out of that building? So how did you find that phrase that it takes 21 days to build a habit? Where did that come from?
Well, I mean, back in the day, I was a youth pastor for many years and was a youth intern. And so some of it came from that, you know, some of it came from, you know, the great John Maxwell, and he had his 21 Irrefutable Laws of Leadership, the book that everybody in the 90s or 8, whatever that was, that we all went through, you know, it kind of was forged from that. And I knew that, for me, it was all about like creating healthy habits and healthy boundaries in my life. That's really where it came from. I mean, I think research now that was sort of one of those things that takes 21 days to form a habit that people talked about. It might take longer now, or people talk about now it's 67 days or 66 days. That's fine. But that's where we got it from.
So you're not thinking of changing it to Building 67?
Yeah, no, not changing it to that. That's still sort of the thing. It's funny because I have 3 kids. I have a 18-year-old son. I have a 16-year-old daughter and a 13-year-old daughter. And my daughter, my 13-year-old, recently has been talking about some of that. And when she wanted to do something healthy, she wanted to do something in her life, she's told me before, like, oh, it's just 21 days, Dad, right? Or she wanted to wake up earlier. And she wanted to like create a habit. And she's like, if I do it for 21 days, right, it makes it a habit, Dad. And I'm like, yeah, that sure is.
That's awesome though. I mean, that's a really cool, you know, kind of like a jump start for youth or actually just any of us to, like, if you think about it, put that mindset of you have 21 days. If you do this every day for 21 days, I mean, it's going to establish something you're probably going to do on day 22.
Yeah. I mean, a routine. That's what I've been learning personally. You know, if we look at my personal life, I've been trying to establish some healthier routines. And it's funny when we have things like this and you're like, whoa, so if I just did it consistently every day for 21 days, it would help. And yeah, it will. Sometimes I fail at it and I realize, well, I guess I didn't do as good a job as I try to preach it, right? But yeah, it's a good, it's something good to aspire to for sure, right? Do it for 21 days and see what happens on day 22.
Well, I mean, you know, and you've mentioned a couple times that you're trying to make healthier choices. What does that mean? What do you mean?
Well, for me personally or for my students, because that's both.
Well, let's start with you, because you were referring to yourself personally.
Yeah, I mean, me personally, I've been on kind of a health journey. More recently, I lost like 45 pounds, and I tried to make healthier habits and choices, decisions in what I put in my body, what I choose to eat. Because for a while I would work out. I did CrossFit for a while. And I just kept putting on weight, just kept gaining weight. And I'm like, what is wrong with me? And realized that you can't, as people say, you can't outrun a bad diet. So I realized I needed to fix the way I eat. And so making healthier choices and healthier habits for myself, along with a healthier lifestyle, you know, that's been first and foremost, most recently for myself. Yeah.
Well, I mean, I think that's great. And so how, let's pivot it over to the youth side. How are you building those habits within your youth?
Yeah. Well, with the students that come after school, part of it is creating some programs and activities for them. I don't think of like Building 21 as the end, that we're the end result in some way, but we are a conduit. And so what that means is for students who do 3D printing, they may realize that they have a passion for something within building and 3D printing. They do a program once, you know, once in a few weeks, but they realize that that leads to something else. Or if they do culinary and they do some cooking, they realize that, oh, that those are transferable skills that I can use somewhere else. Right. But you know, we're not open every single day. Obviously it's not like we're open 21 days in a row, but I feel like the student, right. But the students who come are creating healthier habits here than they would be at home, going home to an empty home, or getting online and doing things they shouldn't, hanging out with people they shouldn't. At least when they come here, they're creating healthier boundaries. We're creating a healthier structure for them. And they're creating a healthier community, right? Because we can't do this on our own. You and I know, I mean, we need a good, healthy community around us. And so we are helping create and helping them realize that you can have a healthier community around you. And this is maybe a good place to start. Obviously this isn't going to be the end game, because they're going to go on to college and go on and do other greater things. Right.
So sorry, I'm stuck on this 21 days to make a habit, but this is the name of your organization. So it's your fault. So but so when you talk about this, does it necessarily mean, is it just 21 days total, or is it 21 consecutive days?
Oh, well, if you're talking about for yourself, like creating a healthy habit for yourself, it's 21 consecutive days. Yeah. Of doing something consistently in a routine for 21 consecutive days. Like that would be, yeah.
Okay. All right. Just clarify.
Yeah.
So, yeah, because I know you probably get that question from your youth. Is like, does it have to be 21 straight days, or can it be like 10 here, 10 there? Anyway.
No, I mean, that's what research would show. Like, if you miss a day, guess what? You're starting over. right? Mm. With the habit, if you're talking about habit forming, then yes, then oh, you missed a day. It's a start over. Okay. It's fine. But now you're going to start with another 21 days. Obviously you and I know in just the rhythm of life, if you're trying to, what we try to do here, the 21 just represents the idea that we're creating healthier rhythms, healthier habits, choices for students.
Nice. And speaking of your students, where do you find your students? I mean, do you have like a boundary? Do you really focus on a certain area?
We have focused on Holton Mason recently, but we have students that come from all over. We have students that come from Lansing that are homeschooled, that are in online school, that are in a charter school. So we do have a diverse, you know, group of students. We started Building 21 in the Holt area though. And so the plan for Building 21 was always to be a more, you know, broad than just one community. And I was putting a plan together a long time ago for a teen center based on the idea that I needed people, I needed coaching in my life. I wouldn't be where I am today if I didn't have coaches and mentors that came alongside me, right? And I knew I needed that. And so I wanted to create a space that students could thrive in with that. And then the catalyst for us launching it was when those three seniors, like 11 or 12 years ago, when the three seniors in Holt lost their life after a tragic accident after a Winterfest dance. And, you know, that comes down to some basic choices that the driver made. The three students who died in the back seat, you know, they weren't bad kids. They made a couple critical, you know, decisions and choices on that day in that moment. Right. And then that was the catalyst that launched Building 21. And so it really encompassed Holt for a while. And then now we've of course branched out, but we have a bus that goes to Holt High School and Holt Junior High and picks up after school. And we're trying to get more into Mason. We have Mason students that come, but we are for everyone, all 6th through 12th graders, you know, all over the greater Lansing area.
And what, you know, you mentioned a little bit of your programming. I mean, is there like, what are the variety of aspects other than a couple of the ones that you touched on? I know that you just mentioned 3D printing is one of the things that they can do or learn from, but what are some of the broad areas that you guys really try to focus on?
Yeah, that's a great question because we are in the middle of redefining some of that literally right now. I went with my program director and admin and we went to Chicago. We just got back like late last night. For 2 days, we visited a teen center there called The Bridge, and they're doing amazing things for teens. Because we're trying to redefine some of that. You know, when we started 12 years ago, it meant one thing. We had had kind of program focuses and certain things, but as we all know, culture has changed, especially in the last like 4 to 5 years. It has changed immensely, especially with the teenage culture. And so we are in the middle of redefining that. But what I could say now, you know, basically, there's a, what we're coming up with now is certainly life skills. So there are programs that are based in life skill kind of things. Elevating students' potential. We've done programs like skill building. We've done financial type programs, but we also have STEM programs. So STEM as in science, technology, engineering, math. And that's where 3D printing comes in. You know, something that gives them kind of a taste of that. And it's a hands-on. So everything that we do when we talk about programs, we want them to be relational and we want them to be hands-on. Like this isn't school. They're not sitting in a lecture hall, right? That we got to have this interactive, right? And it's got to be based in relationship. So the anything that we do And same with like culinary arts and art. They're not just going to sit and watch somebody cook or watch somebody paint. They're going to do it themselves. So we've done things like these happiness journaling, where they write out some things that negative feelings or thoughts they have of themselves. And then they put pictures or draw things and they put it over top of what they feel is hope-filled and positive parts about themselves. And so they put it over top of it, and then they draw a picture or something positive to go along with it. So it's interactive, positive, right? Things that'll give hope. And so we're redefining some of the buckets that every program will fall under. And that's going to be really helpful to move forward. But those are some of the things that we've done with culinary arts. We've done, I mean, a long time ago, Paul, you came out and did that was a while ago, but you came out and did a video program and taught a few students how to create a video. And they started it with like storyboard and from scratch, and then all the way to a finished video, right? So we've done things like that. We've done photography programs, but the core of it comes from we have a teen advisory council, and those students help us come up not only with programs, but help us run certain things. We just started an improv program. So we have an improv group. I don't know if you knew about this, but they're called Free Shrugs Improv Comedy. And they used to be on the West Side over at the Doty Center. And now they're meeting at Building 21 on like the third Saturday of every month. They have a show that they put on, an improv show. And they are also coming on Mondays before once a month and teaching students how to do improv and what that looks like. So, you know, again, it's that came out of an idea of, hey, we want this to be interactive, but they can also be a part of the show. And so the Free Shrugs Improv group was excited because they're like, man, we want to teach the next generation. We've been doing this for 20 years, but how do we teach them? And I was like, hey, that's us. Like, we can help. So they're using the facility and then also teaching a program. So those are the kinds of things that we're doing. And then hopefully we're going to, in the near future, redefine the buckets of what every program will fall under.
Wow. So with the youth that you're bringing in and the programs that are being developed, do you feel like some of that youth rubs off on you?
I hope so. I mean, I was just talking to my, who was I talking to about that? Maybe it was someone in my family, but I can't believe that I am the age right now at 41 that my dad was when I was a teenager. And I always thought he looked and felt so old, you know? I'm like, wait a minute. We just were realizing this. Me and my sister too. We're like, wait, we're that age now. How come we don't feel that old? So I would say that hopefully that's rubbed off a little bit, because I've worked with teenagers for 25 years. I was going to a youth group in sixth grade. So I was 11. And so I started going to a youth group when I was 11, and I'm 41 now. So yeah, you could say 30 years I've been involved in youth ministry. And when I graduated high school, I was, an intern and working with students, in a youth ministry. And so I'm like, I hope it's keeping me young. The gray hair probably doesn't help with that, but
that's what keeps you on the other side. It's like, oh, he seems young, but that gray hair, I don't know.
I know.
No, that's funny. Well, you've mentioned youth ministry a lot, and because it's been a huge part of your journey to where you are today. And that, is Building 21 like an offshoot from that youth ministry? Is it, or is this, has this been something that you've developed, like on your own?
it's something I developed on my own. And the interesting part is it comes from me. It comes from me and my wife and our journey, right? So that's always going to be a part of it, because the vision, the heart came from something that I feel like God imparted to me. And this is my mission. It's not affiliated in the sense that, a church runs it. We have our own board. We're a separate nonprofit. We're mm-hmm. not even a faith-based organization, although I do have faith, and that right. does, that is a driving force in my life, right? But it's not, and it's affiliated. Journey Life Church is a big supporter and sponsor. They're also our landlord, so they give us really cheap rent. You know, that's important when you have a nonprofit. And so they're a big supporter. And, I feel like they've been a big partner in this with us. But it's not an entity of a church. And I really felt like a long time ago when I was setting up the nonprofit that I wanted it to be a community driven, a community-based organization. I didn't want someone to think it was an offshoot of a church, or I wanted people of all beliefs and thoughts and genders and all of that to come in, whatever your orientation is, whatever you feel about who you are, we can come in and help you with your identity. We can come in and help you form good habits, no matter what you believe or where you come from. And I wanted Building 21 to be a safe place for that,
That's awesome. I mean, I think that's what you convey, and that's what actually, and that's what shows up, at least from the standpoint of my experience in being there. And I also remember back in the day when you first started, you had at one point a skate park that was semi-attached to it. I'm not sure if it was like its own thing, but it was a visible part of the whole infrastructure. So talk about that a little bit.
Well, we've been kind of in transition for over four years, but a while ago, 8 years ago, we moved into a facility that had an indoor skate park in it. And that wasn't really a part of my original business plan or thought that we would have a skate park, but obviously that's a cool teenager thing. Like, oh man, our building has a skate park in it. It's a lot harder to run than you think. So we had an indoor skate park in it. When we took over the building, it was just the skate park. And I moved in and I said, if we're going to use this space, it has to be more. We have to be a teen center with a skate park. We're not a skate park with a teen center. So it had to be incorporated into the fabric of who we are. And we started to go down that road. We had renovated the building a few different times. We renovated the skate park a few different times. And then the third time we were renovating it, that's actually the ramp builders had an accident and it burnt our building down. So total to the ground, total loss, everything gone. And that's been over 4 years ago now. And we've been in the process of rebuilding since then. And, that's tough. We were talking about that a little bit on the trip that we took just to Chicago recently that, I think that hurt a lot more. I'm a pretty tough guy. And I feel like, I'm always we can make it through anything and just get over it kind of a guy. And we can power through. But I think that did a lot more, hurt us a lot more than I ever gave it credit, because that, when your entire building burns down and everything's gone, you just are like, where do you go? How do you have a new vision? And we had to move into a temporary space, and we thought that would only be for a couple of years. And now it's been over 4 years, And so it's hard to keep moving forward. We did have an indoor skate park, and we had a computer lab and an art room and a study room and all that in the building. And we hope to have that again. So I don't know if that's why you were asking me, because yes, we are, we are rebuilding. It's just been a very, very hard, long process to, to rebuild. And our new vision, our new goal is, and purpose in that building is going to be with some of the programs that we're going to have, but we also want to have a Ninja Warrior gym in it. And so the future of Building 21 is still going to be a lot of the after school activities and enrichment programs, but we also have access to a Ninja Warrior gym that we would put in it instead of a skate park.
Yeah. When I was asking about that, it was just one of the unique aspects when I first heard about Building 21. I was like, what the heck is this part of the whole? But it wasn't part of the whole mission. And in fact, it's obvious that it wasn't part of the whole mission, because that building burnt down, but the programming and the mission continued.
Yeah.
So that obviously was, you know, that was the key aspect. And so you talked about, obviously it's been between the building burning down and then the pandemic, and you know, you have these two massive, I swear everybody's going to be smiling about at the end of this, I promise, but you know, but it's just, I mean, but you kept your mission going. How proud are you of that, of going from what could potentially be two devastating aspects back to back to where you are right now?
Did you say how proud it glitched for a minute in
How proud are you of being able to continue this mission through that struggle?
I'm pretty proud. It doesn't come without its challenges and heartaches with family, especially my wife. She has put up with this, and it makes you pretty proud. You know, when I go down and visited this other teen center, you know, you have to look at the perspective and say, we could have folded up a couple different times. Gosh, when the fire burns down, it's like, I guess this is it, right? I guess this is the we're done, like hands up, let's, you know, we're done, we're out. Same thing with the pandemic. I mean, there's no after school programs if there's no school, right? Like what are we supposed to do? And so it's really, it makes you proud that, hey, we're still here. And you know, I guess if you look back and you at least have gain a little perspective, you can realize that it's not all as grim or as bad as you maybe thought it was. We're not serving as many students right now, and that makes me sad. But the ones that are involved and coming, it means something more to them right now. And you know, at some point, you just have to realize, hey, I guess it's either a mission and this is a part of who I am, or maybe I need to go do something else. And I just have kind of continued on, hey, this is a part of who I am, and this is what I've been called to do right now. And I haven't been released from that yet. Maybe sometime I will, but I hadn't been released from it yet. So you just say, hey, we're going to keep going and figure it out.
What's the biggest thing that you've learned in your journey as the executive director of Building 21?
I'd say even most recently right now, especially after going and visiting a really successful teen center, probably staying humble and being willing to do things new or different. I don't like change very well, and you have to be willing to change, but you also have to be willing to understand where your deficiencies are and where your strengths are, and lean into your strengths and find areas that you can improve in your deficiencies, you know. Like I said, coming from this other teen center in this visit, you know, I realize all the, it makes you, kind of opens your eyes to all the things that you're not doing right and all of that. And that can be really hard. But, you know, staying humble, and it's like what I always tell teenagers, staying teachable. I think you have to continue to be teachable. Otherwise you're done, you know? And that's the same thing that I've told students. It's the same thing when I've mentored people myself. The minute they become unteachable, it's like, all right, I can't do anything for you, you know? But then you have to look at that for yourself, right? The minute I become unteachable, well, then we might as well fold up, because this, there's going to be a time limit on this. It'll only last for so long. You have to continue to be teachable, right? So I think that's a big part of it. And then the other part would be knowing your identity and who you are. You know, I've been unpacking that more about myself, who am, my own identity, and what God has invited me to, and personally, not trying to grasp at what everybody else is doing. You know, even when you go and visit a really cool teen center and you get all this inspiration, it's really hard. You don't want to come back and just be like, we're going to do all those things, you know, because that's not what we're uniquely supposed to do in this community, in this city, right? And so it's like, how do you, you got to stay true to who you are, not just grasp at what everybody else is doing. I mean, that's what we all did kind of in the pandemic, right? There was so much of that going on. It was like, what's everybody else doing? Okay, we're just going to do that, you know, and we're going to pivot, all that pivot. Oh my gosh, if I hear that word, right? If you hear that word again, like, friends, pivot. I was so sick of that word, you know, but like everybody, and you're like, oh, we're going to do this. We're going to do this now. We're going to do it this way. And I was like, no, now, you know, after all of that and all the dust settled, it's like, oh, well, no, if you just stay true to who you are. I need to figure out how to stay true to who we are, right? Who I am. So that maybe is the best way I could say.
How do you unplug, unwind? What do you do to get away? I know that you have three teenagers in the house. I mean, I know that's part of being able to unwind and unplug, because you have to shift your attention. But what other ways do you, are you able to kind of like, like I said, unwind or unplug away from, you know, just doing the day to day?
Part of it is hanging out, being with the family. Part of my unplugging is actually plugging into the family. So I think I find times at night too. My wife and I like to watch mindless television sometimes. You know, you put the reruns on of The Office or Parks and Rec or Friends or something, and it's just mindless television. And more recently it's been really fun with my kids getting into we started watching reruns of Fresh Prince, you know. It was about the 14th episode, I think. Now all my kids know the song, you know, in West Philadelphia, born and raised, you know. Now they've got it down after 14 episodes. That's part of it, is plugging into the family, plugging into what we're doing at home. Other times it's just my own personal relationship with Jesus, putting on some worship music to and from work, or at times at night. That kind of thing is my unplugging. And then my wife and I have started to create a better, healthier rhythm of going on vacation. We call it checkpoints. We have checkpoints throughout the year with our family. And one of them was like in January, we'd go down and go to Florida, because that's what we in Michigan do, right? And in the winter months, if you're going to get away, you go down to Florida. so that's what we do. And we've done that for a little while, go down there for a week. We have a bunch of yes days with our kids. If you don't know what that is, there's a movie called Yes Day 2. But there, things like that, I think.
So how is what's the best way for people to connect with you or learn about what Building 21 is when you're plugged in?
Yeah. Going to building21.org, spelling out the number 21, building21.org. Probably if you Google it anyway, you'll find us. We'll come right up. Checking out the video there, our website. And then the other best way is, you know, contacting me, benjamin@building21.org. Email me, because I'd love to set up tours. That's what I'd love to do now is, even though we're still in our temporary space, we have another building, the building that burnt down, we're going to rebuild it. Yes, that's the goal. But I'd love to set up some tours, have people go through the place, you know, come and see it, or just at least check out the video online and it'll give you an idea of some of the space, some of the things that we're doing, and contact us that way, because it really makes more sense if you come and visit or you like see the space, you know?
Well, thanks again, Ben, for coming on the program. Really appreciate you being on here and telling us a little bit more about your story.
Yeah, appreciate it. Thanks, Paul. Thanks for inviting me.
No problem at all. And thank you all again for taking some time to listen to this program. So don't miss the next episode, which will be coming out in a couple of weeks. And if there's somebody that you know that you would like to hear more about their journey, please email us at admissioncontrol@unoDeuce.com. And if this is your first time here, please subscribe on YouTube or your favorite podcasting platform and give us a positive review. Thank you again, and see you next time in the Control Center.